Okay, today, guys, we're talking about cell structure, and we're going to try and elucidate a little bit some of the differences between eukaryotes and prokaryotes, the two main types of cells. If you have your It's Learning quiz open, you can take the quiz right while you watch this. It'll make it nice and easy for you. So let's delve in here to the topic. There's two main types of cells that I've just mentioned. There are prokaryotic and eukaryotic cells. And we've been talking about the differences between these cells in virtually every single unit that we've done. So hopefully this is not going to come as some big new surprise to you. So what are prokaryotes? Prokaryotes are bacteria, archaea, bacteria. What are eukaryotes? That's everything else. Plants, animals, fungi, protists, and as an animal, that's you too, right? What are the big differences? Well, first of all, let's say this. The main defining characteristic between a prokaryote and a eukaryote is that prokaryotes lack, they do not have a nucleus. They still have DNA, it's just not in a nucleus. Whereas eukaryotes do have a membrane-bound nucleus where the DNA resides. Some other similarities and differences, well, prokaryotes don't have a lot of the organelles that we're going to talk about today. They do have, I don't want to make it sound like they don't have complex cells, because they are very complex. All life is very complex. But in comparison to a eukaryotic cell, there's just not as much stuff in there. So what does a prokaryotic cell, a bacteria or an archaebacteria, have? It has a cell membrane. Everything that's alive has a cell membrane. Prokaryotes also have a cell wall, which is external to their cell membrane. Some of them have separate little layers outside of that even. Prokaryotes have ribosomes, so does everything else that's alive. Ribosomes are absolutely essential because that's actually how you make proteins. So if you need proteins to be alive, you need ribosomes to make those proteins. And of course they have DNA, which is the code for life itself. So without DNA, ribosomes, a cell, which is what's containing this thing, the membrane, you don't have life. So they basically have all the components to be the simplest life form imaginable. And that's essentially what they are. You can kind of remember the difference here if you remember pro, meaning like no. So prokaryotes, no nucleus. Now eukaryotes are everything other than that. They have many of those same things. In fact, all of those same things, except some of them don't have a cell wall, as the prokaryotes do. But plants, animals, fungi, protists, their cells are considerably larger than a prokaryotic cell. They're complex in that they've got lots more different types of organelles and a lot more different things going on in there. They also have this nucleus. That's the defining characteristic, that they have this membrane sac that holds the DNA. Okay, we'll talk more about that as we go. Let's take a look at some prokaryotic cells. Here's a typical bacterium. And there's an actual microscopic image of one on the right and a drawing of one on the left. So that kind of gives you an idea of kind of what we're looking at here. Notice that you've got some DNA in there. It's all stringy, all strung around in there. You've got a cell membrane. If you look at the layers there, there's a cell membrane on the outside. There's a cell wall outside of that. The cell membrane in this picture is called the plasma membrane. Same thing, okay? And this bacterium happens to have a capsule that's actually surrounding its cell wall. Now, you'll notice some other interesting features. Many bacteria also have these things called flagella, which are those little whip-like tails that help them move about. Some of them also have these little fimbriae, the little pili that are sticking out the sides of them, little like hair-like structures. So they're very simple cells. There's not a lot going on in there. There's little dots on the inside. There are ribosomes. Okay, so we'll kind of continue this as we go here. But I also want you to notice the DNA, what it is inside of a prokaryote. I know it looks all squiggly, but it's essentially one giant loop of DNA. It's one single chromosome all looped all the way around there. And then they also contain other little packets of DNA known as plasmids, that are the little loops of DNA that are inside prokaryotic cells. Now, in comparison to a prokaryote, which is a bacteria or an archaebacteria, the rest of us eukaryotes have cells, or are just a single cell, that might look like something on the right here. You'll note, not from the scale of the picture, but from the scale diagrams at the bottom, that eukaryotic cells can be anywhere from like 10 to 1,000 times larger than a prokaryotic cell. So they are humongous in comparison. Look at all the stuff packed in there. There's all sorts of little organelles that are going on inside of the eukaryotic cell. The prokaryote, in comparison, is much simpler. So we're going to talk about all that stuff. For the most part, we're talking about stuff inside of a eukaryotic cell, and I'll try and make mention of, like, you know, when one does have something and one doesn't have something. So let's turn now to those organelles. When I say the word organelle, what I'm saying essentially is any small structure that has one or more specific jobs inside of a cell. So this is really similar to how organs perform roles in our bodies. We have things like hearts and livers and lungs and kidneys, and those are all collections of cells that have very specific roles. Well, inside of a single cell, there are little things called organelles that have very specific tasks in the cell that they do. And we're going to kind of generalize and break it down. And this diagram here is kind of nice because it gives you a real short, brief description of what each of these are. So you can always flip back to this and take a look at it again in the video, and you'll kind of know what the parts that we're talking about. We're going to talk about essentially each of these in sequence, and maybe add a few more as well as we go. Now, we really can't start talking about parts of the cell if we don't first at least mention the thing that makes it a cell, which is, of course, the cell membrane itself, the plasma membrane. And we've spent some time talking about this already. This is found in all life, prokaryotic, eukaryotic life. It's the thing that surrounds the cell and makes it a cell. It sells it off from the external world. It's also selectively permeable, and we spent a good deal of time talking about that last time. So by selectively permeable, we mean that it lets certain things through and doesn't let other things through. And that's how life maintains a homeostasis, a balance of specific conditions inside, as opposed to whatever the heck might be going on outside. And you might notice some other things about this layered structure here. So I know it doesn't tell you which side's the, oh, it does say the outside is on top there, the inside is towards the bottom. That would be a continuous structure that went around in a circle or however, whatever shape the cell happens to be, a sphere or whatever. But you'll notice that it's made up of these things known as phospholipids. Okay, those are those fatty things that have the little tails that point inwards towards each other and the heads that point outwards. And we spent some time talking about that later. You know, some channel proteins there, some other little things poking off the tops of it that are used for communication and likewise. So that's the cell membrane. It's flexible, it's selectively permeable, and it looks something like this on the microscopic scale. Inside the cell membrane is some material that we call cytoplasm. Now, while it might not really be necessarily an organelle, we usually talk about it in terms of organelles because it's important in that this is the liquidy stuff that's inside the cell. And you could think of it sort of like a jello, sort of a gelatinous fluid. It's not totally just like water. It's a little thicker than that. And all the organelles we're going to discuss are pretty much suspended in it. And there's some chemical reactions that take place in there as well. When we get more into cell respiration later on, we'll find out that the process of glycolysis, basically the start of cell respiration, takes place in the cytoplasm before it goes on further in the mitochondria, which we're going to discuss here in a minute. So the cytoplasm, in brief, the liquid inside the cell. Pretty simple. All cells have this. They got to have liquid inside, right? Now, some cells happen to have something called a cell wall. And cell walls are found in plants, bacteria, fungi, and some protists. Remember, I'm going to say some protists occasionally in here because protists are this weird mixed bag in terms of a kingdom, in that they're not really what we call a monophyletic kingdom. They're a whole bunch of stuff that really doesn't necessarily go together, but we're not really sure what else to do with it. So there's some of these that are sort of like fungus, some that are kind of like plants, some that are kind of like animals. They're a real mixed bag, the protists. But anyway, the cell wall is a hard structure, a more rigid structure, that's outside of the cell membrane. So this provides support, structure. Think about why trees can stand up nice and straight like that, why they don't just fall over. It's due to the fact that they have cell walls, as well as do all plants. So do fungi. So that's why some folks think of fungi as being close to plants, even though they're closer to animals. Bacteria all have this as well. And then again, some protists. It protects the cell, provides support. If you look closely there at the plant cell, you'll see that there is still a cell membrane inside of that. If you look closer to that, I think it's yellowish. And then outside of that is the greenish cell wall. Okay. On the bacteria on the left, the prokaryote, you'll notice that the innermost layer is labeled cytoplasmic membrane. That's the cell membrane. And then outside of that, they've peeled away a little section. That greenish thing is the cell wall. And then some bacteria have an additional little layer called a capsule outside of that. Okay, that's the cell wall. Next up, let's talk about another pretty simple one here. This is the vacuole. And vacuoles are responsible for storing stuff. They're like storage sacks. So many cells have these, some cells don't. We find them kind of all over the place in different shapes because cells have the requirement of needing to store some things. Whether it might be waste they need to get rid of, or water, or even food they're taking in, lipids, fats, proteins, carbohydrates. There's lots of reasons that organisms need to store something, whether they're a single cell or multi-cell. So I just kind of broke down here animal cells versus plants and fungi, because the vacuole sort of serves slightly different roles and looks a little different between the two. Animal cells tend to have many smaller vacuoles, if they have them, and plants and fungi tend to have one large single vacuole. So it's like a big sac. You can see in the picture there the plant cell versus the animal cell. Animal cells oftentimes use those vacuoles for that process of endocytosis and exocytosis that we talked about, I think it was last time, where they, you know, surround some material, form a little pouch out of it called a vacuole, and then bring it inside. And then when they're done with it, they kind of move it back towards their cell membrane and open it back up and exit it back out to the outside. So they'll use these things just to store stuff like that. Plants and fungi, on the other hand, tend to have one big, large vacuole, like the picture there shows, and they might use that to store water so they can maintain what's known as turgor pressure. If you've ever noticed a plant start to wilt, right, and you give it water and it kind of stands back up, well, the big vacuole can store water for the plant when it doesn't have water. It can try and maintain homeostasis and the balance in that environment between, say, salts and things like that in the environment inside the cell. So they're important for a lot of reasons. And we do find these, oddly enough, even in bacteria and protists. Bacteria will sometimes use them for storage or even for buoyancy to float a little bit. Protists, on the other hand, have something called a contractile vacuole, and it's used to actually pump water out of the cell. So they have some different uses, but their main use essentially is just to store stuff. Next up, the lysosome. And you'll see here why I put this right after the vacuole, because lysosomes sometimes have a role to play, especially in protist cells, where they actually deal with helping with the digestion of what food might be in a vacuole. So in the picture there, you can see we've got this single-celled creature here. It's surrounded some material. This is known as phagocytosis. You don't need to remember that. Surrounded some food material. It's brought it into its cell in what's called a food vacuole. So it's got this container with the food in it. And then these things known as lysosomes contain digestive enzymes, and they'll move over and find that vacuole and open up and release those enzymes into it and break it down so that the organism can use that food as energy. And then, of course, the vacuole will make its way to the outside of the cell membrane and open up and release again, right? So these things are involved in digesting all sorts of stuff, whether it's old organelles that need to be broken down, food, viruses, bacteria that have been trapped, maybe even entire cells that have gone bad. These things take care of them. They're known as lysosomes. They lyse, as in the lytic cycle, they break stuff down. Okay, next up is the big one. This is the nucleus. The nucleus is found only in eukaryotic cells. Remember, this is the big difference between a prokaryote and a eukaryote. Eukaryotes, like you, in plants, other animals, fungi, protists, these things all have a nucleus. Okay, that's the point of it. Now, the nucleus, we know, is the control center for the cell. It controls things because it contains the DNA. Okay. Now, there's some parts to that, and I'm going to break them down for you here in just a second. But just know the nucleus is kind of like this ball. If you look at these cells on the left over here that have been stained, the nucleus really just jumps out at you. It looks like a big eyeball in there. So each of those cells has one big giant nucleus inside of itself there. Okay, now let's break down the parts of the nucleus just a little bit more. So within the nucleus, let's start with the nuclear envelope. So there's this, the nucleus itself is basically a membrane. That's why we call it a membrane-bound nucleus. It's a sac that holds all that DNA down inside. And that's what's unique about it. Now, inside of that sac, or along that sac, are all these little holes known as nuclear pores. So they're a little more complex than just a hole, but that's all you need to really remember. What they do is they regulate what gets in and gets out of the nucleus. So it's almost like a cell within a cell, isn't it? And what you're going to find out is a lot of the organelles we're going to talk about on the next couple of pages, including really a vacuole, are essentially cells within cells. The entire cell is basically a series of membranes, little sacs of membranous stuff that are holding things inside, walling them out from the outside world of the cell or even outside the cell, so that they can do a special role. And that's no different for the nucleus. Now these pores, one of their main functions is to allow messenger RNA, mRNA, out of the nucleus. So we're going to talk more about that later, but this is known as transcription. And then to get out of the nucleus, the messenger RNA, which is code carried from the DNA, has to exit one of those nuclear pores. It kind of gets shot out of one of those. It's kind of cool. Then if we look kind of down inside of the nuclear envelope, that sac that's holding all this stuff, there's a couple of things in there. The first thing you might notice is that sort of stringy stuff there known as chromatin. And chromatin is actually what your chromosomes are. This is the material that's all coiled up containing the DNA, safely stored and protected. Okay, so that's known as chromatin. Now there's another dark, like largish spot down there inside in the center called the nucleolus. So notice how similar that is to the word nucleus. Be careful when you're answering the question on the quiz. The nucleolus is not the DNA. This is has a different purpose. The nucleolus makes ribosomes. And we're going to find out just how important those ribosomes are here in a minute. But they're important enough that every single thing that's alive on the planet has ribosomes. So they are essential to life. And the nucleolus is responsible for making those in the eukaryote. Okay, let's move along here and talk next about the powerhouse of the cell. So how do your cells get energy? That happens in this thing called the mitochondria. You can remember it's the mighty mitochondria. It's the powerhouse of the cell. It makes the energy. The energy is in the form of something we call ATP, adenosine triphosphate, and the process is called metabolism that we're going to get into way more depth later on. Now, these mitochondria are found only in the eukaryotic kingdoms. They're not found in bacteria or archaebacteria. I've got a picture of one up there in the top right that's been dyed and blown up quite a bit. Kind of looks like a bean, doesn't it? In fact, they do. In cross-section, if you look at the one in the bottom left there, it looks like a bean, and it's actually got, take a look there, it's got an outer membrane and an inner membrane, and that inner membrane is folded all back and forth. So these are pretty complex little buggers. If you're looking at them in terms of the size of the cell there, you can kind of see that picture, that drawing over on the right. There's a nucleus there with the nucleolus inside. And then you can see the picture of the little bean-shaped mitochondria with a little squiggly line denoting that it's got this folded membrane on the inside. But we're going to come back to this in a little bit here. But I want to make mention that these are unique in that they contain their own DNA. And on top of that, their outer membrane, the outer outside of them, the outer membrane, is very similar to a eukaryotic membrane, but the inner membrane is really similar to a prokaryotic membrane. So let that marinate in your brain for a minute, because we're going to come back to it here in just a second. Oh, my kitty's unhappy. He's sitting on my lap here. So let's turn now to, oh, okay. I don't know if we want to talk about chloroplasts, but we're going to try. So chloroplasts are not found in animal cells. And you hopefully recognize that we're not green and we can't do photosynthesis. So these are found in plants and some protists. And what the function of the chloroplast is to capture light energy and convert it to chemical energy. It takes the energy from sunlight, which is light energy, and then converts it into energy in the form of sugar. So it makes sugar molecules out of this light energy. And it's an amazing process that we'll get into much more detail later on. But they also contain this green pigment known as chlorophyll that you probably have heard of. So these things are what contain the green coloring that make plants look green, that make their leaves look green. So if we're looking at the picture here, the plant cell, you can see kind of roughly the size of the chloroplast there. It's not really to perfect scale, but it gives you an idea of what it might look like. They kind of look like gumdrops. They're kind of flat on the bottom and kind of more rounded on top, little packages. Now, check this out again. Inside of one of these chloroplasts, there's quite a bit of structure going on. There's this stacks of granum, this stuff known as thylakoid tissue, another liquidy environment that's really similar to cytoplasm called stroma. It's almost like a little cell in and of itself. It contains its own DNA just like a mitochondria does, and it's got two membranes. Those are really important hints as to sort of what's going on and why we have chloroplasts and why we have mitochondria. Now, I want to point out one more thing in this picture before we go forward, because I don't want you to goof it up. Plants have both mitochondria and chloroplasts. Okay, animals don't have chloroplasts, but they have mitochondria. So mitochondria are the process of making energy for the cell, making ATP. Okay, that can't happen unless you have some sugar to break down. So the mitochondria need this sugar to make this energy in the form of ATP. Plants, through the use of chloroplasts, can take raw sunlight and convert it into sugar. So, as we're going to learn later on, these two processes, photosynthesis through chloroplasts and respiration through mitochondria, are two sides of the same coin. What one makes, the other needs, and what that one makes, the other one needs. So, in that sense, plants have both those pieces, but animals only have one of those pieces. So, we'll talk more about that later. But I want to turn now to how this happened. How did the eukaryotic cell occur? Because if you look at a eukaryotic cell compared to a prokaryotic cell, the difference is striking. Prokaryotic cells are super basic. Not to say that they're not complex, because all life's pretty complex, but in comparison to a eukaryotic cell, a bacteria, a prokaryote, well, it's just tiny and there's not much in there. How do you go from something as simple as that to something as complex as a eukaryotic cell? So scientists have considered this question quite thoroughly, and there's some hints as to what's going on. And our current theory for explaining this is known as endosymbiotic theory, or endosymbiont theory. And it basically describes to us how eukaryotes could have formed. And it basically says that eukaryotic cells evolved when multiple cells joined together into one. So rather than some giant evolutionary leap where each cell somehow devised this thing called a chloroplast or devised this complex thing called a mitochondrion, what essentially happened was that some ancestral cell engulfed another cell, as cells will do, consumed it, formed a vacuole around it, and then kept it inside. And then rather than this thing being digested, it continued to live inside of the parent, the host cell. Now, it might have been parasitic, it might have lived in there parasitically, maybe it wasn't parasitic, but either way, over time, a symbiosis occurred where the two things began to live so closely together and be so linked that they really couldn't be separated. Okay? Now remember, I told you there's some clues. The first clue that we have to this is that both mitochondria and chloroplasts have their own DNA. In fact, when the cell divides, a cell, an average, regular, everyday eukaryotic cell, has to copy all of its DNA, right? Its nucleus has to be copied. So it makes a perfect copy of all this DNA, and half of that one copy goes into the one cell, and the other copy goes into the other cell. Okay, and then the cell divides. Now, in the case of mitochondria or chloroplasts, some of those just end up in one cell and some end up in the other. They undergo their own cell division, like they do their own copying of their own DNA at different times, and then they make duplicates of themselves, and then those end up in the new cells. Oh, okay. Cat does not like that. So, the chloroplast is a similar thing. Now, the other big hint to this is that if you look at the mitochondria or the chloroplast, both of them have two membranes, and one of their membranes is very similar to a prokaryotic membrane. So, that leads us to understand that it was surrounded by a new membrane by the host cell when it was brought in, but it still had the other membrane. So, you end up with this weird thing that's got two membranes and its own DNA inside there. Now, is there any more evidence? Oh my goodness, we could go on for ages about this. But the other really big piece of evidence is that we found their ancestors. So, in the case of the chloroplast, chloroplasts are essentially very, very closely related to a certain type of cyanobacteria, a bacteria that has really similar DNA, really similar structure. We basically still have their ancient relatives still around with us today. So it's kind of interesting that how that all sort of sorted out and that all occurred. And you can see from the picture there that, okay, cat. So you can see from the picture there that the addition of the chloroplast happened on a separate route, and that's what gave us the plant cell. Whereas the animal cells, they just ended up with the mitochondria. But during the plant formation, we got an extra a chloroplast in there with the mitochondria. Okay, let's move on forward here. Next up, ribosomes. Ribosomes are so essential to life that everything has them. Prokaryotes, eukaryotes. Now, why are they so essential? Because DNA is the code for life. If DNA is the code for life, then ribosomes are in control of making proteins that are life. So the central dogma of biology states that DNA gets converted into RNA, which then gets converted into these chains of amino acids, which are proteins. And you're made up of proteins. Your skin, your hair, your eyeballs, your everything. Your proteins, okay? Even your hormones and things like that are just enzymes or proteins. So, the ribosome, what it does is it makes these proteins using the directions that are found in the DNA. And we've got a couple of photos here. In the bottom left, I have a picture of a blown up ribosome. We're going to kind of draw them as dots when we talk about them, but under a higher power magnification, you'll see they're made up of two units. So there's this bigger thing on top called the larger subunit, okay? And then there's this smaller thing on the bottom called the smaller subunit. So they're made out of RNA, but that's a story for another day. They kind of look like a Pac-Man, and they chomp onto this string of stuff known as messenger RNA that comes out of the nucleus. And as they read the code, they spit out this amino acid chain kind of out the top of that one there. You see it growing. It's called the polypeptide chain. They make this stuff called protein. So they're really truly essential for life. Now, inside of a bacteria versus inside of a eukaryotic cell, they're a slightly different locations. So there's a little addition here. Inside the prokaryote, you'll see in the middle picture, ribosomes are just kind of freely sprinkled throughout the cell. Inside the eukaryote, there are some free ribosomes floating around in there, but you'll also notice that there's kind of a bunch of them, little red dots that are all on that, it's colored green in this picture, material known as endoplasmic reticulum, specifically what's called the rough endoplasmic reticulum. So it's a different organelle, and studded all around the outside of it there are some ribosomes. Okay, so they're kind of throughout the cell, but they're also really, really abundant on this rough ER. We'll come back to that one here in the next slide. So let's talk about that stuff called endoplasmic reticulum. See where it's at on the cell. So it's like attached to the side of the nucleus there. We're going to zoom in on it so we can take a closer look. There's two parts to the ER, which is just an abbreviation for endoplasmic reticulum. Doesn't mean emergency room. Stands for endoplasmic reticulum. So the rough ER is that studded bit that has the bumps, the ribosomes all over it, which are, of course, involved in protein synthesis. So the rough ER, its role is in protein synthesis. Outside of that is a smoother region of it called the smooth ER. And you can even see in the picture there, you see the nucleus inside of all that. So the smooth ER, what it does is it's involved in making phospholipids for the plasma membrane. So remember, that plasma membrane's got to come from somewhere. The smooth ER is what's involved in making that. All right, let's move on forward here to the kind of the next step of the process. If the DNA is the code for making messenger RNA, and the ribosomes can read the messenger RNA and then make these things called proteins, which is what we're made up of, and which do things in our cells, then you need some way to both package and ship these proteins out throughout the rest of the cell to where they need to be, right? So enter in the Golgi apparatus, sometimes just called the Golgi or sometimes called the Golgi body. It'll have Golgi in there someplace if we're talking about the Golgi. So what the Golgi does is it packages these proteins and some other things as well into vesicles. So it can actually make a vesicle. We talked about those already. It surrounds them, pinches off a bit of its membrane, and then it actually labels them. It tags them with specific molecules so that they know where they're supposed to be shipped to. And then it hands them off to special molecules in the cell that move it down parts of what's called the cytoskeleton. So for the most part, all these packages, these little bubbles of vesicles of proteins are carried throughout the cell down this big network of things called cytoskeleton, which let's talk about that now. The cytoskeleton, it seems like kind of like something you really wouldn't need to talk much about, but it's actually really cool. What it is a network of all these little microtubules and microfilaments that are inside the cytoplasm. That's the liquid inside the cell. These things, this kind of mesh, this network of all this stuff, both holds all the organelles in place and serves to move stuff around. It's like a transportation system within the cell itself. And there's some cells that you can see there that the mesh, the blue stuff is the blue dot is the nucleus. And then the rest of that mess is all of the cytoskeleton all over the place. Some of this stuff is like little tubes. Some of it's little filaments. It's really pretty neat stuff. You can see in there in the picture on the left there, there's, you might notice, recognize the mitochondria that are embedded into it, that are held in place there. Now, what's really neat is how things actually move down this cytoskeleton. And I'm going to show you here. In this next little slide here, a little motor protein. So you're going to see this little guy. It looks like a little person actually walking a vesicle from the smooth ER. So it was made on the smooth ER, that big ball in the back there. And then this little thing called a kinesin, which is a special protein known as a motor protein that's involved in transporting. Now it's walking along this big long filament, which is a microtubule, so it's part of the cytoskeleton. Essentially, these things move from inside from inside near the nucleus, near the endoplasmic reticulum, outwards towards the other parts of the cells, essentially the direction that they move. So they actually move pretty fast, and what's bizarre is just how they walk. It looks like they have little feet, but really what's going on is it's almost a mechanical process. There's ATP involved, the energy, and that when that energy is used, it's released as ADP, and the little feet kind of move along this thing. It's actually really pretty cool, and I'm sure that you will enjoy it. So that was a motor protein moving along, and you can see there moving along one of those cytoskeleton filaments there. In the next little segment here, I want to show you a little video by Ron Vail, who's the guy who actually discovered this. So it's kind of neat to literally hear this guy actually talking about this. So let's move on to that here.
Just like a busy city, there's constant motion inside of your cells. There's new construction, demolition, and most importantly, transporting goods from one place in the cell to another. Cells transport goods along cellular roadways. To transport cargo along these roads, the cells use motor proteins. Kinesin is one of these motor proteins. If you didn't have kinesin and other motor proteins, you simply wouldn't be alive. All the cells in your body depend upon these tiny motor proteins to organize and power themselves, to divide and multiply, and to communicate with other cells. Let's start with how you began as a fertilized egg. That egg has to divide into many more cells. All of those divisions require kinesin and many other motor proteins. Development, forming tissues and different parts of your body, requires molecular motion and motor proteins. Every cell of your body requires them for survival. What we know now is that kinesin effectively has two legs, and these legs are able to coordinate a walking motion along a track. That track is called a microtubule, and the kinesin undergoes this beautiful choreographed walking action. While the kinesin is walking along this track, at the other end of the kinesin, it gets hooked up to a cargo. These motor proteins move quickly and efficiently. Relative to their size, they move as fast as a car on a freeway. But they're 4 times more efficient than your car in converting chemical energy into motion. We discovered kinesin in 1984. I was 25 years old at the time and a graduate student. I was interested in the transportation system inside of nerve cells. And what makes nerve cells so interesting is that they're extraordinarily long cells. For example, the part of your nerve cell that has the nucleus, where the DNA is located in your spinal cord. But it can extend a very long tube all the way, for example, to your foot. All of the building blocks for that nerve cell are made in your spinal cord, and all those building blocks have to be shipped to the very end of that nerve cell, a meter away. There had to be some kind of transport system that was moving these building blocks inside the nerve cell, and I wanted to know how that transportation system worked. After we got this transport to work in this test tube. The hunt was on then to find the key molecule that was responsible for that movement. And we eventually found it, and it turned out to be something completely new that no one had ever discovered before. Watching these movements under the microscope, it was fascinating then to figure out, how does this motor actually work? How does something that's a millionth of an inch in size generate that motion? My lab at UCSF spent about 10 to 20 years trying to figure out the answer to that question. We know about kinesin now, we know a lot about how it moves, but there's still so many fundamental questions that we don't know about how all this motility is regulated, how all of these cargos know how to go to the right places. There are always new questions that one wants to know the answers to.
Pretty neat stuff, isn't it? So that's it for today. Go ahead, finish up your quiz, and you are all done.